Hare Krishna. Question: where exactly is sex pleasure located? Is it in our mind? Is it in our body's hormonal secretions? Or is it in the other person's body? Answer: it is in all three. Prahlad Maharaj, in the 7th canto, 9th chapter, while offering his prayers to Narasimhadev, analyzes his pleasure. In Maithunadi Grahameti Sukham Tucham, Kandu Yanena Karayoriva Dukha Dukham, Trupyanti Neha Krupanaha Bhavdukha Bhajam, Kandu Tivan Manasijam Vishaheta Dhiraha. So, he is comparing, there are a lot of points in this verse, let's focus on what is relevant to our point. Kandu Yanena Karayor. So it is like rubbing the parts of a body together to scratch an itch. So basically, what is he saying over here? That now, when there is an itch, at that time there is a mental craving and there is also something physically wrong, maybe a sore spot or a swelling or a bite or whatever. So there is a physical part to it and there is a mental part to it. And the physical part is also real, but the mental part aggravates the physical part. So now, further he's comparing it to the rubbing of body part. You know, when we scratch a itch, that time basically we are rubbing body parts. So that also refers to the idea of, you know, two people are having physical contact with each other. So that is a component. But then he also says, manasijam vishaheta dhiraha. So manasijam. Manasijam means it is born from the mind. Jam is born. So originating from the mind. So basically, there is a component of the mind, our own mind. Then there is the physical component of the secretion of bodily hormones. And then there is the contact with the other person. So now, all these three are there. But let's move backwards now. Let's try to trace it from an analytical point of view, from the other side. Now suppose we see a particular person, a man sees a woman and starts feeling sexually agitated. Now that woman may be a mother and may be carrying her infant on her body. You know, and she may be holding the baby to her bosom, but the baby feels no agitation. So that means if the body itself where the locus of sexual pleasure, then everyone who came in contact with that body would feel that. So it's not only the other person's body. Now, there, of course, now if we move backwards, there are many people who try to get sexual gratification in artificial ways through masturbation and things like that, where they don't have any other person involved. But in general, even in such things, there is imagination about contact with some other person. And there is also a physical stimulus of the organs. So this brings in that the central point, if you look at it this way, it seems to be that there is the secretion of the hormones in the body and the imagination of the mind. Now, so if we move backwards further, now there are some people who may have some biological dysfunction because of which they cannot engage in sex or whatever, they cannot activate their organs or whatever. But now even such people imagine, they watch, they imagine, and because they can't physically enjoy, they feel frustrated by that. But still in that imagination they get some pleasure. So that means there is some pleasure in the imagination also. Now, again, coming backwards, taking another perspective, all of us, before we come to puberty, we don't experience sexual pleasure. So there may be some vague conception of that because nowadays the media glamorizes it so much that there is prepubescent pubescence among children. Prepubescence means before they have actually got biological maturity, they try to become sexually active. That is unfortunate, of course. But the point is, in general, there is a biological biological component without which the mental component is usually not manifested. It's not that it's not there, but it's not manifested. So now, going further backwards, we are souls. And as souls, we are parts of Krishna, and we are meant to eternally love and serve Krishna. And the craving for sex is actually a distortion of the Adirasa, the original, the soul's original love and longing for Krishna. So when we misidentify with ourselves with our body, then the pure relationship at the spiritual level which we have with Krishna, that we project or hope to discover in a relationship with someone else at a physical level. So that means it's a original pure spiritual longing which is misdirected and distorted at a biological level. So the where does the pleasure lie? Well, it lies in all three. Yehi samsparshaja bhoga. So Krishna said that it is samsparshaja. The enjoyment comes by contact with senses of the sense objects. But then again, the contact of sense organs and sense objects, it gives some pleasure. Of course, the pleasure is very temporary, and then after that, the pleasure ends and it gives a lot of misery. But that pleasure comes when there is a desire to enjoy in the mind. An infant on a mother's bosom doesn't feel any sexual gratification or sexual agitation because at that time, the mind does not have the desire to enjoy. So now, for us, in terms of sadhakas, you know, this itself, whatever I discuss might seem a little too explicit for many people, and I don't want to go into any further analysis of this. The important point for us is to recognize that we need to control. So control the senses. Now Krishna says, lust is situated in tasmatam indriyanyadav. He says, indriyani manobuddhir asyadhishthanam ucchate. So he says, lust is situated in the senses, the mind and the intelligence. So that means Krishna is placing the onus on us to control. He is not saying that, okay, there is some person who is dressed in a particular way or who looks a particular way and that's why you are feeling lusty. He says, lust is situated in us. So the lust within us is maybe triggered, maybe activated by some sight. But we can't hold that person responsible because ultimately we all have free will and it is our responsibility to control ourselves. Now, just as, you know, somehow this idea becomes very strong among people that just because someone else is dressed in a provocative way, that makes me lusty. Yes, it may be that makes me lusty, but still the responsibility for controlling is on me. Now, beyond that, of course, a part of civilized culture is to dress modestly, and that is all the more so of spiritual culture. So people in general should not expose their bodies. That's a matter of culture, and that's a matter of definitely of spiritual culture. But the onus for controlling lies on us. So rather than trying to go into a microanalysis of where the pleasure lies, we should focus on how we can regulate ourselves and rise to the experience of spiritual pleasure. So the best way is to spiritualize our imagination. Our imagination in general gets hyperactivated and hyperexcited with thoughts of sex. So if we can spiritualize our imagination, think of various ways in which you can serve Krishna, visualize the beautiful deity of Krishna with our imagination. We may have had darshan sometimes and then we visualize further. And then we can do different visualization exercises also. You know, we can, if we have our own deity, we can visualize dressing Krishna in beautiful dresses and decorating Krishna. Or, of course, it's not only related to the deity. The visualization, direct direction of the imagination towards Krishna can be done in various ways, not just with respect to deity. Whatever services we are doing for Krishna, we can spiritualize our imagination and imagine doing those services for Krishna's pleasure and offering them to Krishna. So basically, if we can spiritualize our imagination, not just curb the mundane imagination, because imagination is also a faculty that we have. And bhakti means not suppressing our faculties, but redirecting those faculties. So spiritualizing our imagination can help us in countering the sexual agitation at its root, manasijam. So in the mind it originates. So we spiritualize our imagination, then that will get substantially reduced. Now, spiritualizing the imagination may require some effort, some endeavor. Whenever the mind goes towards something else, we'll have to redirect it. But that is a part of the discipline that is required for anything substantial in life. What to speak of the supremely worthwhile goal of eternal love for Krishna. And with respect to our own body and other people's body, yes, we need to not unnecessarily titillate or agitate our own body provoke the hormones. Yes, if the hormones are secreted, they may have to be excreted, but that does not mean that one has to indulge sexually. According to Ayurveda and according to Vedic scriptures, that actually when a person doesn't have sexual thoughts, then the hormones don't get secreted also. But even if they're secreted, they can be excreted by various means. One doesn't have to indulge in sex to excrete them, either in whatever way. And certainly, we know that lust gets triggered by looking at attractive forms. So we minimize looking at those forms, and we keep our eyes chaste when we have to interact with people also, and we don't glance in wrong directions. So basically, recognizing that the sexual pleasure actually is just a infinitesimal drop, and that to a distorted version of our original spiritual love for Krishna and the eternal happiness therein, we minimize all the places from which it gets stimulated, from our imagination, from our bodily activation, and from contemplation, from perception and from contemplation on others' forms. And in this way, we can gradually become purified and relish more and more spiritual happiness at the pure level. Thank you. Hare Krishna.